by sinful men, torn and beaten, then nailed to a cross of wood. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame for the wrath we stand forgiven at the cross. Oh, to see the pain written on your face, bearing the awesome weight of sin, every bitter thought, the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath we stand forgiven at the cross. Now the day flees, now the ground beneath quakes as its maker bows his head. Curtain torn in two, dead are raised to life, finish the victory cry. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath we stand forgiven at the cross. Oh, to see my name written in the wounds, for through your suffering I am free. Death is crushed to death, life is mine to live, won through your selfless love. This the power of the cross. Son of God, slain for us. What a love, what a cost, we stand forgiven at the cross.
Thine be the glory, risen conquering Son. Endless is the victory thou, O death, hast won. Angels in bright raiment rolled the stone away, kept the folded grave clothes where thy body lay. Thine be the glory, risen conquering Son. Endless is the victory thou, O death, hast won. Lo, Jesus meets us, risen from the tomb. Lovingly he greets us, scatters fear and gloom. Let the church with gladness hymns of triumph sing. For her Lord now liveth, death hath lost its sting. Thine be the glory, and conquering Son. Endless is the victory thou o'er death hast won. No more we doubt thee, glorious Prince of Life. Life is not without thee, aid us in our strife. Make us more than conquerors through thy deathless love. Bring us safe through Jordan to thy home above. Thine be the glory, risen conquering Son. Endless is the victory thou o'er death hast won.
Creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Who has told every lightning bolt where it should go, or seen heaven storehouses laden with snow? Who imagined the sun and gives source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night? None can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God, and none can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God, incomparable and unchangeable. You see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. You are amazing,
God. Give you a warm welcome to our Songs of Praise service Glad you're able to join us wherever you are. We continue our series focusing on Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. Today, through the hymns, testimonies, prayers, and an address by Philip, we're rejoicing in Jesus, who is himself the truth. As we come to prayer, we're also aware that it's Father's Day. So as we give thanks for our fathers, we echo the words of the Apostle Paul in his prayer for the church in Ephesus. Let us pray. We bow our knees before you, our Father God, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. We pray that according to the riches of your glory, you may grant that we may be strengthened in our inner being with power through your Spirit, and that Christ himself may dwell in our hearts through faith as we are rooted and grounded in love. Grant us, Lord, this we pray, the assurance of faith with the forgiveness of all our sins. In Jesus' name, amen. Liz will now introduce our first song, To God Be the Glory, after which Ros Brench will read from John chapter 14, verses 1 to 11.
Hi, for those of you who don't know me, I'm Liesl Horton. I've grown up in a Christian family and have a Christian husband. I was so excited to be asked to choose a hymn. If you know me, you know that I love all songs and hymns, so it wasn't going to be difficult to choose one. The song that I have chosen failed to achieve wide usage in the United States and was included in very few hymn books. But in 1954, a song leader for Billy Graham handed a copy with this suggestion, and it was put into the London Crusade, and then they also used it in America. It was written 149 years ago by Fanny Crosby. The song I'm talking about is To God Be the Glory. Now, I've got something to tell you at the moment. I cannot sing one note. I don't know if you can see, I've had a total thyroidectomy. Please continue to pray that I will be able to sing a note very soon. I've just returned to work. I work with 4 and 5 year olds. They took one look at my scar and said, it looks like you've got 2 mouths now. Imagine a teacher having 2 mouths. I love children, always honest with how they see things. So I've had to think about other ways of enjoying singing at the moment. I'd never really thought about other ways. I whistle and I hum. I used to sing all day and night, usually loudly. Anyway, back to the hymn. We chose this hymn as the first of our wedding hymns. Beautiful words, lovely tune, and it demands a heartfelt response. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Come to the Father through Jesus the Son. We're all welcome. No one is refused if we come to the Father. We don't have to be perfect. Phew. We just need to put our faith in Jesus. And if you need help with understanding that or trusting that, write into our church or ring and someone will help you to understand it. To God be the glory, great things he has done. Who loved he the world, that he gave us his son. That's Jesus. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, Christ's, to every believer, the promise of God, the vilest offender who truly believes. That moment from Jesus, a pardon receives, not when we've got it all sorted, but as soon as we believe in Jesus. Do we believe? Do we know that assurance? What is our response? Praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Do you ever think that when you see the stars, the moon, the sea? Do you want to rejoice? It tells the gospel. Great things he has taught us. Great things he has done. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son. There isn't any other way to come. There's no other name in which we can come to the Father. Purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our rapture when Jesus we see. What is our response? Give him the glory. Great things he has done. Do we? Do we give him the glory? Do I? Not enough. God deserves all the glory. Let's respond now and mean what we're singing. Or if you can't sing like me at the moment, you can still sing in your heart and mean every word. Let's praise the Lord and give him the glory. To God be the glory. Thank you.
Our first reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verses 1 to 11. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the place, the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. Jesus answered, Don't you know me, Philip, even after I have been among you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you are not just my own. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. or at least believe on the evidence of the miracles themselves.
Our next song directs us to the saving power of Jesus, after which Rachel Thurley will testify about the truth of Jesus, followed by Rita and Tony Goodwin leading us in our prayers.
What I want to share with you this afternoon is the way that God has been so faithful to me for the whole of the last 70 years. He made a promise that he would be with me, and he has been true to that promise. So I'm going to start right back when I was 17, and I knew there, like a lot of teenagers, I'm sure, that there was just something missing in my life, and I was, you know, a mixed-up teenager in many ways. And I didn't know what was missing, and I didn't really know why it was that I felt that church might produce the answer, but that is indeed what happened. Though my family had never gone to church or mentioned God even, yet I went to church, and eventually I heard a message, and the message was based on the verse that a lot of people know, which is when Jesus said in the book of Revelation, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and sup with him and he with me." And I just opened up my heart to the Lord at that time, and I have known that he's been with me all those years ever since then. And it really changed my life. Even I can remember from the next morning, the world looked a different place. Well, I'm not going to go through all the 70 years, because God has guided me through all of them in different ways. I came to take a job in Huntingdon, which was really key to what happened next, because it was there that I met my husband, Tom. And then we joined together to the church, which was then in Silver Street, containing 19 elderly people. And we just prayed. We believed it was the church that we should go to. And we prayed that by the time we had children and they were growing up, that there would be a church with young people and youth work going on for our children. Indeed, one of the families who came along and provided children who were plagued with my children is here today in the form of Philip. And God was true. I mean, by the time our children were of that age, there was a youth work going on. And of course, can you believe that there were just 19 elderly people in the church, and how it is today? God has been so faithful and good to us all. Then the next thing that I'll just mention briefly is that happened when we were in our 50s. And after a visit to India, where Tom had been brought up, we felt God's call to go out and work there. And I'm sure a lot of people wondered what we would be doing. And we didn't know either at that time, but we knew that God was faithful and he had called us and that he would show us the way. And we trusted the Lord. And when we got there, we found that there was a real work to be done among very poor Anglo-Indians. And that work has gone on for the last 30 years. And we have seen literally hundreds of children, hundreds of older people and disabled people who have all had their lives changed in many different ways as a result of that. God was so good, and he kept his word when we went out that he would be with us in all that we did. And now the thing is that he continues to keep his promise. I'm not able to go to India, not much I can do. I had to use a pusher to come up to do this talk. And even though I'm not able to be active, yet I know that the Lord is still able to use me, and I know that he is still with me, and I know too that he will be with me, as he has promised, right until the end of my life.
This afternoon, whether at home or at Little Stookley, we are gathered as church, for we are God's people wherever we are.
His promise is that when we gather together in his name, he is there with us.
Thank you, God, that you are here with us now. Thank you that because of Jesus, we can enter freely into your holy presence. We give you praise, Lord, because you are God, our rock and our redeemer. You loved us so much that you sent Jesus to reconcile a broken world to yourself. Thank you that he has paid the price of our wrongdoing and given us the hope of eternal life.
Help us during this time, when things are still far from normal, to continue to trust you, knowing that you have promised that you are with us even in our darkest moments. You have said that you will never leave us or forsake us. Please be with those who are still fearful in these days. We ask for your comfort.
We also ask that you would be with those who are unwell in body or spirit or mind at this time, those who are struggling with medical, personal or financial needs because things have had to be put on hold during the pandemic. Let us pause now to name before God in our hearts those known to us who need his special touch at this time.
Your word tells us that we should pray for our national leaders. We ask for your wisdom and help for all those in government, that you would help them in the decisions they have to make, especially during this coming week when the next stage of lifting lockdown restrictions come into force.
We pray, Lord, for our church family at GBC, that you would continue to be with us as we consider the appointment of an associate pastor. Be with our leadership team as they seek to make decisions that will enable us to be a light for you, shining in the community of Godmanchester and the surrounding area.
Finally, let us join together in praying the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Pat Reed, with support from Kath Pickersgill, introduces her favourite song, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Oh, now, Pat, what's your favourite hymn?
What a Friend We Have in Jesus. It's my favourite hymn.
Yeah. You've always said, whenever I say to you, what's your favourite hymn, you say, what a friend we have in Jesus.
I like the... sorry, Kath, go on. Yeah. I like the words in it.
And yeah.
The words touch my heart, and they're really lovely. I love the words in that.
And we've been talking this morning about the way you have a cross on your wall.
Yeah.
And it's got a figure of Jesus on it.
Yeah.
And when you see the cross, it reminds you of Jesus, doesn't it?
It does, that's right. And a cross on the lounge come kitchen door.
Lovely.
And I've got the cross like you've got, Kath.
That's right. And when you have trials and temptations, it was quite a trial in that first lockdown, wasn't it?
It was, Kath, yes.
And sometimes you've got a lovely cousin called Liz.
I have.
And Liz would phone you up and she would sing with you on the phone. Do you remember?
Yes, I did.
What kind of things did she sing with you? Did she sing What a Friend We Have in Jesus?
Yes, she did.
Because she knows you like that one.
Yeah, I do. I like other songs, don't get me wrong, Kath, but that's...
That's right.
Yeah.
And we have friends. We've got a good friend called Jude Lechmere.
Yes, we have.
What did she put on your fence?
A bird table.
Yes, that's right. And what do you see on the bird table now?
Birds. And fat balls are there.
Yeah, that's right. And your friends in the church were praying for you.
Yeah.
And some of them did things like Jude, giving you a bird table.
Yeah, that's true, yeah.
And when we go for our walks, we see people at the food bank, don't we?
We do, yeah, like Phil.
That's right. And sometimes when we're walking past the church, we see Daniel Beckett.
We do, that's right, Daniel. And we saw Holly the other day.
That's right, yes.
Holly.
So we have
Holly,
friends.
Yes.
Yeah, it's Holly. And we have friends who pray for us and care for us, don't we?
That's true, besides Jesus, obviously.
That's right. And when you were a little girl, your mum used to go to Brampton Church.
She did. She was in the choir, my mum.
That's right. She was in the choir.
Yeah.
And she'd say, I'm just going to choir.
Choir practice. She was telling Dad as well, that she was just off to choir practice.
So
she used to go on a Friday night. My mum did.
So all your life,
yeah,
you've known about Jesus.
I have.
You've been encouraged, knowing that you can pray to him any time.
Yeah.
And we feel safe when we pray to Jesus,
we
don't
do. We do. That's right, Kath. Yeah,
that's
we
right.
do.
Yeah. I'm really glad that you've chosen this hymn, and now we're going to hear what it sounds like when the group sing it. Okay?
Okay, Kath, yes.
In Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? Should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Are we weak and heavy laden, cumbered with a load of care? Precious Saviour, still our refuge. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find a solace there.
Ken Collett brings our next reading from John's Gospel, chapter 8, verses 31 to 36, after which Stephanie Brown will share with us how she knows that Jesus is true.
Our second reading is also from John's Gospel, and we read from chapter 8, verses 31 to 36. To the Jews who had believed him, Jesus said, "If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are Abraham's descendants and have never been slaves to anyone. How can you say that we shall be set free?" Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, anyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs in it forever. So if the Son sets you free, you are free indeed."
How can I tell you that I know Jesus as the truth in my life? Some of you will know that I've spent just over 35 years practicing as a medical doctor. The Ipsos Mori Veracity Index has for a long time shown doctors to be one of the most trusted professions in the UK. Do people trust me because I know the truth? Doctors are trained with a lot of emphasis on evidence-based medicine. However, everyone knows that the evidence that we have today is true, but can be proved incorrect in a few years' time. The evidence is always based on good research, but in populations and may not always apply to some individuals. Our trust in doctors is not based on the evidence they know, but because we listen to one another, build a patient-doctor relationship, and then decide on a diagnosis and management together. I think this is similar to my understanding that Jesus is the truth in my life. As a young scientist, I needed evidence that Jesus existed. There was plenty of historical evidence, but a skeptic can always find alternative explanations. What confirmed my belief that Jesus is the truth was learning about the way he lived, building a relationship with him, and trying this way of living for myself. I now have a tried and trusted friendship with Jesus. I started this journey of discovery in my teens and have never regretted it. I have doubted it many times, as we all do when going through struggles. But two of my favourite verses always put me back on the right track. Proverbs 3, verses 5 to 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him and he will make your path straight. These verses talk about needing to trust with your heart and not your head. Sometimes scientists and doctors find this difficult to do because they're born problem solvers. So what does true friendship with Jesus look like in my life? Here is another verse from the Bible which helps me. Numbers 23, verse 19. God is not human that he should lie, not a human being that he should change his mind. Does he speak and then not act? Does he promise and not fulfil? Jesus is totally reliable, trustworthy in his advice, wants the best for me and speaks truth into my life. He listens and reflects back to me in many different ways. He guided me when I was a strong-willed teenager wanting a career in veterinary medicine. He showed me very gently when working at a veterinary surgery that my gifts lay in communication, explaining issues to pet owners and helping them in their crisis. Just what a doctor does without the animal as a go-between. He also has a wicked sense of humour and found me a husband whilst I was deciding. He showed me that being fiercely independent was not always a blessing when I went into premature labour with my second child at 23 weeks. He wanted the best for me and my child, so he provided me with wise physicians and a loving church family who blessed me with their willingness to help whilst teaching me patience in being looked after. He spoke to me when I did not know how to help my staff through the trauma of losing a baby from sudden infant death syndrome in the surgery building, despite attempts to resuscitate. God very clearly spoke out loud the name of a previous work colleague whilst I was driving to work praying, who only too willingly came and listened to the grief of my staff. He walked alongside me when I was angry about the loss of my husband's job and helped me to understand and find the ability to forgive others in that situation. He has patiently and reliably listened to me when I have had issues with staff at work who are being difficult and disruptive in the team. He has shown me that the love I have received needs to be shared with others when they're hurting and hitting out. He is always present at any time of the day and night, and I can discuss things knowing he is listening even at 3 a.m. This is when I wake, thinking, overthinking, excited, needing to discuss a good idea, or just worried about my family. And I can share this with him. How many people could you ring at that time and not get a grumble back? 2.3 billion people in the world believe that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. We know what Jesus says in the Bible and know that following his example works for us.
Our next hymn points us to the coming of Jesus, the Saviour, and our need to respond with confidence for the future. Then Philip will speak about Jesus, the truth.
From heaven you came, helpless babe. Entered our world, your glory there. Not to be served, but to serve. And give your love that we might be. This is our God.
to bring our love as a daily offering of worship to the Sovereign King. There in the garden of tears, my heavy load he chose. His heart with sorrow was torn, yet not my will, but yours, he said. This is our God, the Servant King. He calls us now to follow. That flung stars into space to cool man's surrender. This is our God, the Servant King. He calls us now to fall.
Father, I place into your hands the things I cannot do. Father, I place into your hands the things that I've been through. Father, I place into your hands the way that I should go. For I know I always can trust you. Trouble me, always can trust you. Father, I want to be with you and do the things you do.
Father, I want to speak the words that you are speaking to.
Father, I want to love the ones that you will draw to you. For I know that I am one with you. For
today we're looking at Jesus' claim to be the truth. What did he mean by that, and how is it relevant to us? What is truth? This was a question Pontius Pilate put to Jesus when he'd been arrested and would shortly be put to death. On that occasion, Jesus gave no answer, but he previously just said, "The reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." That's also in John's Gospel, chapter 18, verse 37. So Jesus said that truth most certainly can be found in him. Sadly, we could say that truth seems in rather short supply in our world today. We have government ministers and advisers appearing before committees of the Houses of Parliament to be quizzed on whether they're telling the truth. We live in a society which talks about fake news and alternative truth. My truth could be different from your truth. Truth doesn't seem to be so reliable as it ever was. How can we tell if someone is telling the truth? In a court of law, if you're called to give evidence, you'll be asked to swear that the evidence I shall give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. But how do we know it will be? Surely it depends on the character and honesty and reliability of the person saying those words. When Jesus says, "I am the way and the truth and the life," can we be certain it really is true? Surely it can be so if Jesus himself is completely trustworthy, honest, reliable, and of exemplary character. So what do we know about Jesus and his life? We know that he spent his life serving others, not himself. We know that he was not afraid to confront evil in hypocrisy, even if it finally cost him his life. We know that he upheld the Ten Commandments, which are the basis of any civilized society. We know that some of his revolutionary teaching would make for a better way of living if we practiced such attitudes as love your enemies. And we could go on. The Bible tells us he never sinned and was perfect in every way. He could see into the hearts of those who were trying to trick him. And he willingly gave his life to achieve his Father's will and purpose, that the whole of humanity might be saved by his death and resurrection if they believe in him. Jesus was and is to be trusted and relied upon as a person of absolute honesty and integrity. And as we've already seen, he said, "The reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth." So what is this truth that Jesus claimed to testify to? Well, I suggest this truth is to be found in the person of Jesus himself. Hence, I am the truth. He's the truth about God, because he was and is God. Jesus, who was born of his mother Mary, but as the angel said to Joseph before he was born, conceived by the Holy Spirit. Jesus, the man who was God. Jesus, the Son of God. Jesus as God incarnate. God in the flesh. God walking this earth in the person of Jesus. The Apostle John, who spent 3 years living alongside Jesus, puts it like this at the beginning of his Gospel. "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." Jesus, who came from God, full of truth. As we heard in our first reading from John chapter 14, just after he spoke those words about being the way, the truth and the life, he said, if you really know me, you will know my Father as well. Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. We cannot see God. We cannot see Jesus now as his first disciples did. But we can see and know him by reading the Bible, by praying to him and his Father, by asking him to reveal himself to us day by day. We've heard the reality of that in our two testimonies this afternoon. If we see him, Jesus, we have seen the Father. So we can know truth about God by looking at Jesus. In Jesus, we see the very character of God himself. Then Jesus shows us the truth about ourselves. As we compare ourselves to him, we realise we fall short in every sense. In the book of Romans in the Bible, this falling short is called sin. And the writer goes on to tell us that the wages of sin is death. And without God's forgiveness, we remain slaves to sin. Now, slaves need to be set free. This is where our second reading from John's Gospel chapter 8 comes in. When Jesus was talking to some of the Jews one day, he said, if you hold to my teaching, you really are my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. The truth that Jesus taught was that whoever we are, we need to know forgiveness for our sins, that it is through his death and resurrection that this is accomplished. And by believing in him, we can be free from our sin, free from its consequences, free from its power, and one day, free from its very presence. We are no longer slaves to sin, but we are free to love and obey God as one of his children. Set free and welcomed into the family of God, adopted as sons and daughters with all the rights of a natural child. Truly children of God. Finally, Jesus shows the truth about how we should live. He both demonstrated and taught the way that God would have us live our lives. As we read the Gospels and the rest of the Bible, we see what life could be like if we live it by God's way, under his rule, in his kingdom, willingly subjecting ourselves to him as our king. He can help us do this if we let him. How much better would this world be if we were all living God's way, totally submitted to him? So, what truth do you believe? Is it your version of truth? Or is it God's? Do you believe that Jesus is the truth? If so, as you put your faith and trust in him, you can know a peace and a purpose for this life as you know God's forgiveness, the joy of being one of his children, his loving presence with us now in the midst of the turmoil and uncertainty of everyday life, and the glorious hope of life with him forever in the future one day. May God grant you the faith to believe and to know his truth found in Jesus, the one who said, I am the truth. And now a prayer. Father God, thank you for the love you have for us and all people. Thank you that out of your love, you sent your Son, the Lord Jesus, into this world full of grace and truth. Thank you that he died in our place, so that we might know you for ourselves as our Heavenly Father. Help us believe that you, Jesus, are truly the way, the truth, and the life. This we ask in your name. Amen. Our final song reminds us that Jesus calls us to crown him Lord of our lives. So we sing All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
Thank you to all who've taken part in our service and to Sam, our technical director. You may remember that after our Songs of Praise services, we have been used to enjoying fellowship over tea together. Well, now a tea is being arranged for Sunday, July the 4th in the afternoon at 4:30 p.m. in the car park at Godmanchester Baptist Church. Tables and chairs will be provided and tea will be served. You are all invited to attend. Further details will appear on the screen at the end of the service. If you haven't received an invitation and would like to come for tea, please let us know. This is a pre-booked event, so you will need to inform us if you intend to come. Our next Songs of Praise will be broadcast at 4 p.m. on July the 18th, and we invite you to join us then. In the meantime, you can also share in our Sunday morning worship from Godmanchester Baptist Church every Sunday at 10:30. These services are available through the church YouTube channel. Now, a final blessing, based on words at the end of the first letter of John. And we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding, so that we may know him who is true. And we are in him who is true by being in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. May the blessing of Jesus' loving presence go with us all now and forevermore. Amen.